almost everybody. How many of you ready for your kids to go back to school? I wish it'd start tomorrow, bless God. Get those kids back to school, be a good time. Pray for those teachers. Yes. Amen, pray for those teachers. That's a big job. Y'all found out how hard it was to be a teacher during COVID. I'm just being honest, man. During COVID, you were like, let that teacher ask for supplies. She'll never do without again. Bring an extra Kleenex, extra glue, whatever she needs, extra Starbucks card. I'm keeping my teacher happy. Right? Else some kid's going to come back to my house and Lord God, that is not God's will. So anyway, be praying for our teachers and our students as they go back, man. There's a lot of things that our teenagers and our kids go through that we never had to face. There's a lot of stuff they hear at school that we never heard at school. And so it just amazes me. But let me also tell you a couple things. Next Sunday, very loud. I want to appreciate all those that got here early for the 8:30 service that starts next week. But if you were here today, hey, it's great rapture practice. Amen. Great rapture prayer. You're ready to go up when it's time to go up, man. And so I appreciate that. But next Sunday, we'll be back at 8:30, 10, and 11:45. Now, I want to say this. This is not going to be a popular announcement, but I just got to be honest with you where I'm at right now. I don't know that I can preach all three services on Sunday. If you were here at last service last week, you'll notice my voice has given me a lot of problems, and I think just 30 years of wear and tear of preaching is finally catching up with this old man. So my goal was to go till I was 55 doing all three, and that would be 3 years away. So I don't know where I'm going to land next week. I may try it. But if not, man, I know that we got some incredible staff members on this stage that can carry the weight. Amen? Amen. Come on, man. You don't got to like it, but we got to celebrate it. So I enjoy preaching, but I also enjoy being able to have a throat. And I know God's got for me a lot for me to accomplish. And I don't want to miss out on my opportunities without using wisdom. Does that make sense? So the only one that I know on Easter weekend, I usually preach five messages that weekend. And I'm looking forward to having doing six this year. That would be stinking awesome. And I would love that, man. So we'll just pray for the Lord to add increase. I know God's doing things. We had a great altar service last week. Many people coming to the Lord. How many of you know that failure's not final? Hey, we learned that last week, amen. And so a couple things I want to tell you, 8:30 next week. Also, man, if you are not currently volunteering here at the worship center, we need some help in our parking lot, and we need some help greeting and ushering. That doesn't take a whole lot of work to do either of those things. In your case, well, I'm not called. You don't have to be called to park a car. You just have to be available. Did I knock the shout out of y'all already? I mean, well, the Lord hasn't called me. Your pastor is, though. Your pastor's asking for your help to help us park some cars out in the parking lot, and we need some help. So, man, stop by guest services, see Pastor Paul. Let's make those things happen. It's easy to do, and I promise you, there is something that happens by serving others that will never happen in your life until you do that. All right, we ready for today? So welcome to week number two of our five-week series called Running with the Giants. And I've done a series like this before, but this one has new characters. And one from the last series that I just decided to preach again because I really like that character a lot. But can we real quickly give a big welcome to our online campus and our first-time guest today? So every week we have an anchor verse, and here's that anchor verse. I'm going to read this every week. It's Hebrews chapter 12, and it says, therefore. Now, anytime you see therefore in the Bible, that means it's just a continuation of what's already been said. I want you to follow me with that. So this is just a continuation of chapter 11. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders us and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run our race with perseverance, the race marked out before us. Can you give me a little more monitor, Will? Life's race can be a little tough from time to time. Thank you, sir. And then someone comes alongside of me. I don't know if you've ever been having a hard day or a bad go at it, and out of nowhere, somebody just comes along or calls you and says, man, you are on my heart. I just wanted to pray for you today. I just want to encourage you not to to give up and not to give in. And they say, man, you got this. And this is what's happening here in Hebrews chapter 12. They're saying, don't give up. You can make this race. And so we have people in the stands, not only the saints of God or the heroes of God, but if you have loved ones that have already gone to heaven, can I tell you that they are in this cloud of witnesses and they are encouraging you not to give up and not to give out, to make it so that you can see them again. Isn't that good news? Amen. So just keep in mind, though, they see everything. Oh, that done knocked the shout out of people. I didn't know they saw everything. I thought they was just encouraging me. No, they see you when you at like Bebe's kids. So each week, we're taking one of the characters out of the stands, and we're giving them opportunities to give us advice of what they would tell us to keep running. And the idea came from a book. I'm a big reader. I don't know if you read, but John Maxwell wrote a book called Running with the Giants, and then he wrote another one called Learning from the Giants, and he wrote a third one called Wisdom from Women of the Bible. He didn't want to call them giants, and I think that's wisdom right there, amen? And so today, we're going to talk about Mary. Mary, the mother of Jesus, who really is misunderstood in scriptures. And there are some beliefs that have turned her into a god. But I believe she would say, I'm not the focus, but my son is. Jesus is the focus. And in all likelihood, she was probably a very frightened teenage girl, somewhere between the ages of 13 and 16. And when the angel visited her and told her, says, you're going to get pregnant without ever being with a man, and you're going to get pregnant with the Son of God. Now, that came with all kinds of questions, as you can imagine. Anybody with me on that? One being, who is even going to believe a story like that, that you could get pregnant without being with a man? That's one part of it. And then when you go, everybody say, and not only that, I'm pregnant with the Son of God. Don't you think that a lot of questions are going to come up out of that? And I think she would tell us, if you're ever in a place where God doesn't make sense, if you're ever in a place where God asks you to do something that's outside of your comfort zone, if you ever felt that you prayed and God took your whole life story in a different direction than what you prayed for, if God has ever been confusing to you, I believe she would tell us when that happens, don't miss your moment with God. No matter what you've been praying for, can I tell you, he has a bird's eye view and he has seen the end for the beginning and he knows everything in between. And so you might be praying for some stuff that you want, but God is going to give you what you need. I need about 7 people to come go with me this morning. Don't miss your moment with God. It's bigger than what you can think or imagine, and God is going to work better in your life than you can possibly imagine. I think she would say, and be prepared, because God's ways are not always our ways. Any of you learned that lesson yet? They're not always our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. And because of that, it won't always make sense, because God's not like us. But here, I don't want a God I can understand. That would make him human. I want a God that sees the whole picture. And because if you always got to have it to make sense, you're going to hate following God. But don't miss your God moments. I want you to know that God is trying to have more moments with you than you realize. I'm preaching to somebody already. God is trying to have more moments with you than you can possibly realize. And God is reaching out all the time. And you may say, then I'm just missing my moment, Pastor Todd. And I think many times we simply give him the stiff arm, or that we're too busy to hear what he's trying to say to us. But Nate, no mistake about it, our God is a speaking, talking, order of God. And he's a reaching God. And he's trying to talk to some of you right now. You're not hearing me. You better wake. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, don't go asleep. Look on the other side. Say, you wake up too. All right? Our God is reaching. And God, listen, God doesn't have a speaking problem, but sometimes his people have a hearing problem. And so I think she would start with this. God's moments often seem impossible. God ever told you to do something, you're like, there's no way I can do that. That's how you're going to know it's a God thing. It should be bigger than you when God speaks. And when he comes along, he's going to give you some news or ask you to do something, and he's going to come into your life and say this, and you're going to think, I don't get it. What? I don't understand it. Let's look at her story right here in Luke chapter 1, verse 31. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you're going to call him Jesus, and he will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. Watch her question. How will this be? Anybody ever been there with God? How, God? How? Mary asked the angel, since I'm a virgin. She was letting go of some of her fears and some of it, like, God, I don't get that right now. I hear what you said, but it doesn't make any sense in my little mind right now. Listen to me. God is going to and will do some things in your life, and it won't always make sense in your head. God will ask you to do things, and it will not. He will ask a shepherd boy to go out and fight a giant with a slingshot and a rock, and it doesn't make sense. He'll ask a man to build a boat when there's never been rain because the earth's about to. You're not hearing what I'm telling you. God will always ask you something bigger. And I have people tell me all the time, it's like, Pastor Todd, I can't follow it if I don't understand it. Then you are going to miss the best part of God, and you have just reduced Almighty God down to the size of your little brain. If you've got to understand it before, listen, Peter would have never walked out on water if he had to understand it. You don't want to bring God to where he always has to fit inside of your head. Get out of your head for the most part and get in your heart. When you get to the place that I'm going to trust him, even if I don't understand him, I'm going to follow him, even if I don't know where he's going, I am going with him. This whole message is a message of trust. This whole message is a message of taking God at another level than you've ever had with him before. Listen, we were prophesied to many, many times to have a child. And you know what? We lost two before we had Hunter. Can you understand why that might cause you to doubt the word of God that's been spoken over your life? When you're trying to reason that you're going to have babies, but your babies keep dying. And I'm telling you this because I don't just preach what I'm talking. I live this stuff out as well. And sometimes I got to trust God even when it doesn't make sense. Which leads me to this, Mark chapter 10. Jesus looked at them and said, with man, this is impossible, but not with God. Say it with me. All things are possible with God. See, you got to get that in your spirit. And I think Mary would also tell us this. When God moments come, just say yes. Just say yes. No matter how crazy it sounds, no matter how outlandish it sounds, no matter how much money you got in the bank, you're not hearing me. No matter how many people are going with you, just say yes when God speaks. You'd be surprised what would happen in your life if you just start obeying the voice of the Lord. Don't try to figure it out. Just say yes, because the next line, I believe the next line in this verse, in my opinion, I don't have Bible for it. I can't tell you exactly this, but in my opinion, this very next line is where Mary got pregnant. Luke 1:38. She says, I don't know how you're going to do this, but I am the Lord's servant. I think at the moment she said, I am the Lord's servant, I believe personally, is when she got impregnated by the Holy Spirit. Mary answered, may your word be fulfilled to me. And then the angel left. His job was done. Watch this. And I think right there, by the power of the Holy Spirit, conception happened. And you realize she probably didn't feel this in the days to come. She's going to begin to show, and she's going to be pregnant. And she's going to be pregnant outside of wedlock. And you know, her family and probably even people in the community, because how many of you know people can be hateful sometimes? And you don't even got to go outside the church to find hateful people. And I think people were like, really, Mary? Like you and Joseph couldn't wait? Y'all couldn't just wait just a little bit. I mean, seriously, you have no concern for the level of shame that you brought on your family and on yourself? Didn't you think about anybody but yourself? And I'm sure Joseph, look, I'm sure Joseph is sitting there going, I got a lot of questions myself. Y'all blaming me for getting, I don't know, she just showed up like this. We're just rocking along, dating, and the next thing I know, so I'm just as confused as everybody else is. And the religious people were probably like, you know, we stone people for situations like this, right? You know that's what happens. There was ridicule, there was confusion, probably a lot of anger. And I love the fact that Mary was like, I don't know that I understand all of what you're saying, but let your word be fulfilled, God. Let your word be so. When God speaks, I don't know who I'm preaching to, but I'm prophesying over you. When God speaks, God is going to do what he said he was going to do. Remember when Jairus comes to Jesus and he says, my daughter's about to die and I need you to come right now. And Jesus went right then, the Bible tells us. And he makes his way and other people start tugging at him and other people start trying to get his attention and from the crowd. And he's slowing down because he's healing other people. And you know, Jairus, I'm just going to preach it from my point of view. Jairus is like, bro, do you not understand how serious this is? We've got to go right now. It's getting too late. You got to hurry, Jesus. It's getting too late for you to do anything. And then someone comes and says, tell the master, hey, don't worry about it. She's already dead. Can you imagine how Jairus must be feeling at that moment? If he hadn't stopped to take care of everybody else, my baby girl would still be alive. If he wasn't concerned with all these people, man, they just probably had like a broke leg or a broke. My girl's about to die. And he got sidetracked over a broke finger. I wonder if you've ever been there with God. When you don't understand why he didn't do the thing you thought he would do when you thought he would do it. Don't tell the master. Tell the master, don't worry, he's already dead. Mark 5:36. Overhearing what they said, Jesus told them, I don't think so. That's my opinion. That's Kevin Todd Turnbow version right there. Jesus said, don't be afraid. Just believe. Think about that word right there. Don't be afraid. Just believe. And we know that Jesus goes on to raise her from the dead. We wanted her to be healed from sickness, but God wanted her to be raised from the dead. You understand what you want and what God wants isn't always the same thing. That's why the scripture says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then all these other things will be added unto you. Why can they be added to you at that time? Because your heart and his heart aren't so different when you're thinking about the kingdom instead of yourself. I'm just trying to help you a little bit this morning. And I want this, but God did that. That's why I tell people all the time, Trish and I have 4 kids. One we got to raise, and the other 3 are in heaven living, raising, being raised by God and being raised by my grandmother and being raised by my daddy. But can I tell you, it wasn't easy going through that, but I'm trusting God with all of that. I have decided that I'm going to trust God even on the hard days. I have decided that I'm going to trust God even when it doesn't make sense to me. I have decided that I'm going to trust God even when I don't like it. I'm going to trust God even when I don't feel it. Why? Because he's God and I'm not, and he knows better than I do. I trust him. I don't trust him with just the easy stuff. I trust him with all of my stuff. And you need to get there as well, where you're just trusting God. And I think Mary would also say this. I think your God moment will open the door for God's best in your life. I think when you start trusting God at levels that you've never trusted God before, you'll get to see things that you've never seen before. Listen to me. The love of God and the favor of God are 2 different things. I just said a mouthful, and I don't even have time to teach all that. God loves everybody, but the favor of God are only a select few. I can show you, he only shares his secrets with his friends. So if you're not hearing God's secret, then where are you at in your relationship? Because he's not a respecter of people. He don't love me more than he loves you, but he does respect principles. Are y'all even here this morning? I feel like I'm at the wrong church. I really feel like I'm in the wrong church. Y'all better come. Larry, I'm going to need you to take a lap here in a minute. I'm going to let you to wake them up. There we go. Your God moment will open up the door for God's best, meaning that when God is moving, it may be way different from what you would like him to do, and you have to know that he's right, and what he wants is better than what you want. And I'm convinced of that. By the way, I have decided that I'm okay with getting some explanations when I get to heaven. You realize, well, yeah, there are always these people all the time. I hear that when I get to heaven, I'm going to ask God this, and I'm going to ask God this, and I'm going to ask God. You know you're not going to have to ask him anything. You know when you get to heaven, it's going to all drop down on you. You're going to be like, oh. You're going to be just like him. Come on, somebody. And so you're going to get that download, and you're going to be like, The Bible says, well, how do you know that, Pastor Todd? Because the Bible says when we see him face to face, then our eyes will be made open. When we get there, the phrase, you were right, Lord, will be coming out of a lot of people's mouth. What about this? No, it's not going to be what this. Oh, you were right. You were right. Oh, I'm glad you did that. Thank you so much for loving me. Thank you. I think you're going to hear that more than thank you for not letting me marry him. Thank you. Oh, God. Thank you, Lord, for letting me hook up with her. Thank you. She's not even here, Lord. Thank you. I'm just being real. And on earth, you saw how her kids turned out. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. That's shady right there. Let me go on. You have to know that God has the best things for our lives. And I think there's a point that maybe Mary didn't believe this. And I think she got discouraged, and that's why she left Nazareth. Now, this is my opinion. I think that's why she left Nazareth, and I think that's why she went to go see Elizabeth, her cousin. And here comes, in my opinion, discouraged Mary because of all the ridicule and all the talk and all the gossip. Everything's been said to her. And I think this is why, this is what happened in her life when she got to see her cousin, Luke chapter 1, verse 42. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child that you will bear. I think she's telling her how blessed she was because Mary's not feeling too blessed in the moment. I think she's got a friend that's encouraging her because Mary doesn't feel too encouraged in the moment. And I think, saints of God, that's why it's so important that you have the right community in your life that can get you going when you don't feel like you can get going. I think she's telling that blessed is she who has believed that the Lord would fulfill her promises to her. Not the woman who understood it. Watch the words. Not the woman who understood it. Not even the woman who saw it happening already. But blessed is the one who believed it was going to happen. Sometimes that's all you are more blessed just to believe than you are to have it. Man, you're missing me this morning. Why did Elizabeth act that way? She's a little bit older than Mary. Go do your homework a little bit. She's a little bit older. Brother Jack, she's got a little more experience. There are things. Can I tell you this, Brother Jack? You'll appreciate this. There are things I preach way bolder now than when I first started preaching. I've been doing this 30 years, and there are some things I preached 30 years ago I would never preach today. Anybody ever grow in the Lord? I'm the only one. You start preaching something, and then you start studying the word, and you're like, oh, that's not Bible. That's not Bible. That's TV preacher. That's a book I picked up, but it's not Bible. Just pray for your pastor. He's still a work in progress. You know what happened? Listen to me. The word didn't change. I say I start preaching things bolder than the word didn't change, but my understanding of knowing God and understanding his word has matured and it's grown. And I've had my own set of heartaches, and I've had my own experiences in the last 30 years that's helped me grow in the Lord. When you have history, it will give you better understanding. When you have history with God, it will give you a better understanding of why he says what he says and why he does what he does. But if you've got no history, you have no marker. And when you have no marker, you will wander. Even in their story, let's fast forward 30 years. where Jesus is about to launch ministry, and Mary has now been a mother for 30 years. And when you think about this, she's been a mom for 30 years. She's got a different outlook 30 years later. She's no longer questioning, how's this going to work? She's moved from a point of questioning to a place of confidence, because the very next time you see them is at a story at a wedding. And Jesus is 30 years old, and they run out of wine. And Mary said, Jesus, they're out of wine. Fix it. He says what any man would say at that point, woman. I'm just reading the Bible. Woman, what's this got to do with me? And Mary, being just like my mama, drops the mama card on him. Moms have the power where they can just voluntold you. Y'all ain't never been voluntold by your mama? Just wait. You're going to get voluntold, and you just got to do it. And she goes to the guys, and she says, hey, my son is going to come over here, and he's going to say some stuff to you, and you're going to think he's out of his mind, and you're going to think it's not going to work. And you're going to say, that's not how you make wine. We made the first pot of wine. We know that's not. You're going to want to say that. But John chapter 2, verse 5. But whatever he says to you, just do it. Would to God that all of us would live by that moniker right there. Whatever he says, that we would all just do it. Amen? Listen, we don't have any Bible, but you have to know from the ages of 12 to 30, he must have been doing something that gave her the confidence to know that he could do that miracle. I know this is the first time we see it, but he must have been doing something behind closed doors that made Mary believe she could make that statement, something like this. Jesus? Yes, Mom. We're out of milk. I need you to go down to Circle K because they're all over now. Or Brahms, because it's cheaper. Everybody, I just gave y'all a little hookup right there. Y'all didn't know. Poor man's got poor ways. Galen Turnbow right there. I need you to run down to Brahms and get some more milk. And he's like, Mom, I don't want to go to the store right now. She said, Jesus. And I think he said, Mom, go on, check that fridge one more time. I think they went to kids' birthday parties. And she's like, Jesus, get in the pool, not on top of the pool. Get in the pool. Now. Don't come out here just showing off. Get in the water. That's just my opinion. I think something like that had happened. I think one of the little kids across the street, one of the chariots came by and killed one of their dogs. And if it was a cat, he wouldn't have helped, but he killed one of their dogs. I think one of them dogs got hit by a chariot and they saw the little kid out there crying, and Jesus went over there and go, what's wrong with your dog? Ruff, ruff, ruff. And I think Mary's like, get in the house right now. You're drunk. Something had to have happened, guys, is all I'm saying. Something must have happened for Mary to know. Am I making sense? I'm saying she had history with him, my God. And when you have history, you have references. Help me, Lord. Here's the point. The history with God gave her a confidence of, I don't know how he's going to do it, but I know he's going to do it. It may not sound like that's how you're going to make wine, by putting water in a pot. But if Jesus says put water in the pot, you better get ready to drink. Not like y'all think, though. Everybody, we're going to get our drink. Oh, No. Listen, I want to be the voice this morning that tells you that you're blessed. I want to say that again. I want to be the voice. If no one tells you more this week, man, and I'm a little emotional because this is really speaking to me while I'm preaching this. If no one else tells you this week, I want you to know that your pastor told you on the first day of the week that you're blessed. And I know you're sad. And I know some of you may be confused. And I know that you're wondering, some of you here, like, where is he at and what he's going to do? And I'm telling you that God is at work in your lives in ways that you don't even realize or you understand. If you believe that, give God a good shout of praise. You are blessed. You are blessed. If you are a son and a daughter of the King of Kings, you're blessed this morning. And I think before I send Mary back up into the bleachers with the other clouds of witnesses, I think she would leave us with some parting words this morning. And I think the first thing Mary would tell us is this. Number one, no matter what's going on in this world, stay connected to God. No matter what the news says, stay connected to God. No matter how you feel, watch that. That's the biggest one. No matter how you feel, stay connected to God. Why? Because feelings are real. They're just not realistic. They're based on how you see, how you feel. And you can't always trust how you see. You ever pull it out and you're like, yeah, and somebody hits you and you're like, oh, I didn't even see them coming. Or you pull it out and you, oh my God, you can't trust your vision all the time. That's why we need to trust the Holy Spirit with our blind spot. Come on, man. And so he's working in your life. Stay connected to God. And I think the enemy to our connection with God is the pace of our lives. Man, I'm going to hone in on a couple of things right now, and it may not be popular, but it's powerful. I think the pace of our life dictates a lot of our relationship with our God. When I have a better place, a better pace, I'm in a better place. And where I have this time with God where I just slow down, and I'm not so busy running to this event, to that event, to this thing, to that thing, to here, to there, that I'm not so busy doing ministry that I don't forget to get ministered to. Sometimes, watch this, sometimes we're out being a ministry not because we're called to it, but because it feeds something in us that we have. We have a desire for it to be fed. It wasn't because God called us. It's because we called ourselves, and now we're having to figure out why it's not working the way we thought it would work. And then it'll never work when you work outside of what God's called you to do. Just because it's a Todd idea doesn't mean it's a God I feel. Where I just slow down, and if you look at these words from the Christmas story, and I know it's not Christmas, but just look at the words for the Christmas story, and it's kind of the theme for our society today, in my opinion, in Luke chapter 2. Watch this, verse 16, the very first thing. So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told to them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. Everyone is running all over the place except for Mary. Did you notice this? Why? Because Mary was a worshiper. Mary was a worshiper. Watch this. You're going to find it out right here. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered on them in her heart. Everybody else is rushing off being busy, but Mary pondered on these things in her heart. See, some of you, I don't know who you are. You have to identify yourself with the Lord. Some of you are due with a time of pondering where you just let God give you assurance that he's in your life and that he's working in your life. See, even if you don't have the energy to pray anything, sometimes you ought to just show up and sit there with some worship music on and let God begin to heal your heart and energize you again. Because if you're not careful, you'll be out giving so much words and encouragement to everybody else, you'll lose your words to him. If you understand the gravity of what I'm preaching, it'll change your life forever. I'm just telling you, I don't think I'm a great preacher, but I'm telling you, this is an awesome message. I'm going to buy my own CD today. I'm telling you, it's that good. Matter of fact, I'm going to preach it again next service. That's what I'm going to do. Listen to me. Where you just give time to God just to be connected to him. And Jesus himself said this out of the message verse in John 15. When you're joined with me, and I'm with you, the relation, intimate and organic, the harvest is sure to be abundant, but separated, you can't produce a thing. God says, when you spend time with me, message version, when you spend time with me, you're gonna have an abundant harvest. But when you're not spending time with me, you're gonna have barren fields. Some of you, that's where you're at this morning. You're so busy. We got our kids fixing to go back to school, and y'all been playing baseball all year, and you've been doing whatever, softball all year, and so I mean, it's a year event. It's not just a season anymore. Our kids play sports in a year-round thing, and we're in it. We're there. I get it. But because of it, some of you got so busy, you got disconnected from God. Yeah. Now watch this. I'm not saying you're not going to heaven. What I am saying is that you're running on fumes. I'm going to say that again. I'm not telling you you're not going to heaven. I'm saying that you're running on fumes because you haven't been in his presence in a while. But if you would do that, I promise you, he would assure you that everything's going to be fine. Amen. That he's got the whole world in his hands. That little song, "We Lived in Kids Church," sometimes comes to be very fruitful in our lives. Got in there. He's got the whole world in his hands. 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 He's got the little bit. No, you're going. Remember? And I don't know why I went there. Like, Jesus is this small. He's got the little bitty baby. Even Ricky Bobby knew how big. Just trying to help you there. Here's the second thing I think Mary would tell us. I think she would say, stay connected to your purpose no matter what's going on around you. Stay connected to your purpose no matter what these end times look like. Hi. Stay connected to your purpose no matter what these end times look like. And we're not living in the last days. We're living in the last of the last days. Again, you want to know how the last days is going to end up? Everything begins and ends with Israel. Watch that. I think what kept Mary going is what she realized she had responsibility of carrying God around. Wow, that's powerful. She had the purpose of carrying God around. And I think there were days where she probably wasn't excited about that. And she needed some encouragement to fulfill her purpose. Watch this. When Jesus gets dedicated, and by the way, at the worship center, we baptize believers and we dedicate babies. We don't baptize babies until they're older and understand what they're doing. And I don't understand why other religions do it that way. Jesus didn't get baptized as a baby. I just knocked a shout out of half the church right there. But show me. If it's not enough, we make up some traditions to make ourselves feel better. We baptize believers and we dedicate children back to the Lord. That's for free. You can write that down for free. Here we go. But watch this in Luke chapter 2, verse 34. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, this child is destined. This child is destined. Why would he have to tell her that? Maybe she just needed a reminder of what her purpose was again. Maybe some of you on your last leg and you just need to be reminded of what your purpose is again. And it's not just to suck air and go to church. God has given you a call and a gift on your life for everybody that's here and everybody that's watching online. Maybe the noise of the people had gotten into Mary's head, and maybe for some of you, the noise of the world has gotten your head and told you you're not qualified, you're not this, you haven't been saved long enough, you don't know enough. Maybe the noise has gotten her head and in her life, and that reminded her that she was a woman of purpose, and so was the thing she was carrying. And I want you to know that you are people of purpose, and so is that gift and that calling that you're carrying. If you need to ever be encouraged, this morning is the day that you should take this whole message. This child is destined to cause the falling and the rising of many in Israel and to be a sign that will be spoken against so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed. Listen, knowing the purpose of your life is one of the keys of success to your life. That's the whole reason we do Growth Track here at the Worship Center. And if you don't know your spiritual significance, the ministry that you're called to do, whether or not you're doing it, you are called by God to make a difference in the world. And if you do not connect to that thing, your life will stink. If you do not connect to the purpose that God has called you to do, your life will not count. You'll be miserable your whole life, and you'll wonder why I'm miserable. The whole reason you're miserable is because you're not doing what God called you to do. For some of you, your life may change next week when you start volunteering in the parking lot. Wouldn't that be amazing if all I had to do was start serving others in order for my life to be different than it is right now? Would you also know that Jesus said, I didn't come to be served, I come to serve. So if you want to be more Christ-like, we need some more volunteers in the parking lot next Sunday. And the whole church said,
amen.
Amen. That's the loudest one I heard in a long time. We're going to be overwhelmed with parking lot people, bless me. Guess God, listen to me. But if you know why you're here when life gets tough and when life begins to hurt, you'll rise above it when you know what you're called to do. I'm just telling you, in 30 years of ministry, not everybody's loved Pastor Todd and Pastor Trish. And I know what you're thinking. What's not to love? And you're right. But my pastor used to say this when I was 15 and 16. He said, you better get a backbone like a saw log. Yeah. And I'd like, what is he saying? I never knew what Brother Bryant was saying when he said that. You could tell I listened to that man a whole lot more than he thought I listened to him. But being in the ministry a little bit, you better get a backbone like a saw log. And I'm telling you, you better be able to stand up to some of the words that come against you and some of the accusations that come against you and some of the things that people have to say. Because there have been times that I have to remind myself that you got to preach on Sunday so you can't act out right now. You ain't never called yourself to lay hands on somebody? Saints of God, I grew up on the east side of Lubbock. It is in me to fix a situation. It is in me to help the Holy Spirit with an attitudinal adjustment. You heard? It is in me. So I got to lay that to the Lord sometimes, man. And I'm just telling you, when you know why you're here, when life gets tough, you'll rise above it all. You won't hear what they say. Look what Paul said to Timothy. This is why I remind you, 2 Timothy chapter 1. This is why I remind you to fan into flames the spiritual gift God gave you when I laid my hands upon you. You got to fan that thing on the inside of you when nobody else is doing it. We want to help fan that spiritual gift in your life to make a difference in this world. And when you know why you're here, life is so much better. And here's another thing I think she would say. Stay connected to people who encourage you. That's imperative. Stay connected with people who love little Debbie like you love little Debbie. Because if this apocalypse happens, or you've been seeing it on Facebook, does anybody even know where little Debbie lives? I don't know where she lives, but I know where she keeps some stock. See Pastor Todd for all your little Debbie needs, bless God. And Bluebell. We're going to have no steak. We ain't going to have no pork chops. We're not going to have beans and potatoes, but we're going to have some ice cream and some oatmeal cream pies, bless the Lord. Stay connected to people who encourage you. Listen, she didn't just go to visit Elizabeth. That would have been a weekend trip. Jack, I never saw this till I was putting this message together. That would have been a weekend trip. But she stayed there for 3 months. I don't love anybody in my family enough to stay at their house for 3 months. Oh, don't ooh me. Y'all know the same thing, Pastor Todd. Are we connected somewhere? Yes, sir. She says, I'm not going back to Nazareth. You know why? Because everybody there is hateful. I'm not going back to the mean people. I'm not going back to people who encourage me. If I came out of drugs, I'm not going back and running with all my drug addict friends. If I'm trying to, listen, if I'm married, I'm going to cut off my single friends and be married. You're willing to risk your marriage to run with little stomach ache and little pistol starter. You're willing to risk your marriage so you can hang out with Earl. Trish ain't got to worry about Earl. Earl ain't got nothing I want, but Pastor Trish got a lot of it. You heard? I'm just telling you the truth. Cut off the people you need to cut off and be in community with the right people at the right time, and you'll continue to go up. You know why I never struggle with drugs again? Because I quit running with people who do drugs all the time. You know why I don't struggle with alcohol? Because I didn't even go to the weekend barbecue where everybody was drinking. Well, it's just a drink. Well, it wasn't just a drink for me. It was a drunk for me. I didn't want a drink. I wanted a drunk. And so in order for me to go where God had called me to do, I had to cut some people out of my life. And I had to have some people roll their eyes at me. And I had to hear people tell me, you think you're so holy and you think you're so righteous. And all I said, I'm not judging you. I'm judging me. I choose me. I choose me. Eternity is longer than you can possibly imagine. And I choose me and I choose him and I choose heaven. You don't got enough Dos Equis. You ain't got enough barbecue to talk me out of my place with God. It ain't worth it. A weekend barbecue is not worth it. Pastor Todd, you sound really religious. Am I really religious or am I really relational? Because the word of God says, not if you go a churchgoer, not if you're a priest, not if you're a pastor, not if you're a nun, not if you're a prophet, but if you're my people, you will obey my commandments. Whew, I digress. Let me get back here. Stay connected to people who encourage you. She went there. Watch this, Luke 1, chapter 56. Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home. She said, I'm staying here with a woman that called me blessed when I showed up looking discouraged. I'm staying with a woman that encouraged me when I didn't look like much. That's one of the reasons to be in church every Sunday that you can be in Sunday. That's one of the reasons you need to be in community groups so that you can hear me and you can hear others in the body of Christ tell you that you have a purpose and that you have a calling and that you have a plan and that you are going to make it. You're going to make it. Watch this, Hebrews 10:23. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who is promised is faithful, and let us consider how we may spur on one another. You need somebody to spur you on sometimes. You need somebody to spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together. Why we go to church? Because of that right there. Not giving up meeting together. That's why I should have turned that off. I'm using Hunter's iPad, and it's messing me all up this morning. It's got OU Sooners on here and everything. Right? Are y'all hearing me? Listen to me. You shouldn't forsake the assembling of yourselves together. Well, do I got to go to church to be saved? No, but it helps. I don't got to go to AA not to be an alcoholic, but it helps a little bit. Right. Celebrate recovery helps a little bit. Right. It depends on how bad in shape you are. If you're in bad shape, I don't want the guy that barely got out of body shop school. I want the one that's been doing body shop for a little bit. I want Big Daddy working on my car. When I have an issue with my car, who to call? I call Lance. Hey, Lance, tell me where I take my car, because Lance don't do it no more. I don't call Earl. I want somebody, if your name is Earl, sir, I apologize. I see Gomer right up there. I preached a message one time about Gomer, and I ain't met this lady, never. And Sherry comes down to say, she goes, hey, I just want to introduce myself to you this morning. My name's Gomer, and I went, oh, snap. It was a bad day because I did. I said things like, if your name is Gomer, you really better be a looker. You think a lot of people is calling Gomer's house for a date? And so Sherry tried to drop me on that, and I was like, Sherry, you're the devil. And she goes, but I got you, didn't I? I said, yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am, you did. Thank God that you were here. Listen, not giving up meeting together, why? As some are in their habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Listen, God from the very beginning said, it's not good for man to be alone. But you have to get to the right people in your life. And we're getting to the end of Mary's recording in the Bible. And Jesus is 33 years old now, and he's hanging on the cross. Help me, Lord. And she's watching her purpose. And she's watching her son be executed. And I've always heard this taught from Jesus's perspective and what he went through, I've heard it preached from the Father's perspective, what he gave for us to let his only begotten Son die for us. But have you ever considered what that looked like from Mary's perspective? What she must have been going through. In my mind, one of the hardest things in the world is for a parent to have to bury a child. I'm just being honest with you. That is unimaginable to me for a parent to have to bury a child. And we've had to lead some families through that. In 25 years of ministering, I've had to do services for children. And I've been asked, what do you say to the family? Well, this is exactly where Mary is. And I don't think it's a coincidence that this is one of her worst days in her life. And she's not by herself. She's in a community. John chapter 19, verse 25, the Message version. Jesus's mother, his aunt, Mary, the wife of Cleopas, and Mary Magdalene stood at the foot of the cross. Jesus saw his mother and the disciple he loved standing near. And in all the pain that Jesus had been through, it's amazing to me that he still had the ability on the cross to continue taking care of others. And he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." And the Bible doesn't say this, but when I read that, this is how I read that. "Mom, I can't be your son anymore because I have to go pay for Todd Turnbow's sin. And as bad as this looks and as hard as it is for you to look up on this cross, I want you to know that I came to do this so that none should perish. And I don't want you to look up on this as this is the last time that you'll ever see me. I want you to know I'm going to be more alive than I've ever been. But if I don't do this, there's no hope for Todd. If I don't do this, there's not another way for him to ever be reconciled back to my father again. And then he looks at John and he says, "John, I want you to take care of your mom." And from that moment on, you never read where Mary lived anywhere else. And she accepted John as her son, and he accepted Mary as his mother. And he dies, and she now has to walk away from that scene. And I wonder, how did she make it? How do we make it? How do we make it through the tough days? How do we make it through the dark days, through the difficult days? Here's the answer. This place is not my home. Heaven is the answer to every one of those questions. Heaven is the answer to every one of your pains, every one of your troubles, every one of your traumas. Heaven is the answer. And I think too often we put too much emphasis and base so much of our happiness on a place that we're just passing through. This is not our home. We are strangers. We are aliens in this land. And the only place in Scripture, the only place, and you could check your pastor to see if he studies right, the only place in Scripture where it adds the word blessed to the word hope, and that's when it's talking about heaven. Hope. Blessed hope. The best hope is that one day we will see him face to face, and he will be whole, and we will be whole, and we will be in his presence forevermore. And if you're here and you're like, "Man, I don't think I can make it anymore. I want you to know that you can make it. And you say, Pastor Todd, you don't understand. Here's number four. Here's my last point. Stay connected to the bigger picture. You don't think you can make it? Stay connected to the bigger picture. This is not it. This is not over. I had two funerals last week. I'm going to see both of those people again. It's not goodbye. It's just I say, when I do a service at a graveside, I always close with that. This is not goodbye. This is just I'll see you soon. At my dad's service, the same thing. Daddy, I'll just see you soon. I'll just see you soon. We are aliens and strangers passing through this life, and life is but a vapor, and it won't be very long, church. Let me encourage you with these words, that we will be with heaven with all of our loved ones, and we will be with Jesus forever, and you should never, ever, ever forget that truth, no matter how bad your day is. No matter how bad it's going, you should never forget that truth. But some of us this morning have lost sight of that, and that's okay. You can't help where you've been, you can help where you're going. I don't ever get mad at people for dumb mistakes that they made in their past. I got a whole book of them. That's just the thing, though. They're in our past, guys. Your past only has as much power as you resurrect it. Well, Pastor Todd, I would never resurrect my past. Sure you do. You tell the stories over and over again. I said this last week, and some people got offended at me. You can be offended. I don't care. It doesn't change the truth of the statement. Some people don't want to be healed. They just want to be heard. And every time you tell that story, you get angry all over again. You get mad all over again. You're not looking for healing. You're looking for support. You know the best way to get past your past? Quit telling your stories. Who wants to hear stories from way back when? What's your story of what God's doing today? What is God saying to you today? And many of us don't know because we haven't sat in His presence long enough to hear anything. Because we've been busy, 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 been busy doing everything but the thing that matters. Well, how do you know? Because I've been busy, busy, busy doing everything that matters, and sometimes I forget. And sometimes I read my Bible to preach. Sometimes I read my Bible to teach at Sunday School, SOM, School of Ministry. Sometimes I don't read my Bible to get nourishment. Sometimes it's at the end of the week and I'm like, oh no, I forgot to study. Pastor Todd, you're the pastor of the church. You don't think my week happens just like your week? You don't think there's times when I get home and the last thing I want to do is open the Word or pray? Well, your pastor should love everybody. Love's not the issue. Sometimes fatigue is. Don't you ever just, can I be real with you? Don't you ever just get tired of people? John's feelings. It just happens for a little bit. But I'm being there. Sometimes I'm just like, so I don't want to go where everybody knows my name. Oh, that's the last place I want to be. Because when people know your name, expectations come with it. Sometimes I don't want nobody to expect anything from me. I just want to be. Tomorrow, I'm going on a 5-day vacation with my family. I'm just going to be. I'm going to be on the beach, though, and I'm going to be somebody's struggle. But I'm going to be. And I ain't going to answer my phone. And I'm not going to check my emails. And I'm not going to answer my texts. You know why? Here's my week last week. Last week, I had to do 2 different funerals. And on the way back from preparing one, I got one of the most devastating phone calls I ever got from my life, from a lady that goes to our church. And I can't go into the details of it because it's not my story to tell, but let me just tell you, it is one of the most devastating stories I've ever heard being in ministry. And for the first time in 30 years, I feel incapacitated to pastor this church. I didn't know my heart could hurt to the level it hurt when I got that phone call. It had nothing to do to me. It happened what happened to her and her children. Last week, I sat in the green room and Pastor Shane come in there, and I'm just sitting on the couch crying. He says, "Are you okay?" I said, "Man, I don't have nothing to give right now." The only thing I had to give, and you're going to be offended with me, but I'm just going to be honest with you. My daddy used to say this all the time. And he didn't say these words, so I'm going to change it up so I can say it at church. Right now, I ain't giving out nothing but bubble gum and butt whoopings, and I'm all out of bubble gum. And all I wanted to do was go hand out a whooping to this person. Because they need it. Man, he needs it. But he still has a soul. And I don't get to pick and choose who goes to heaven. But it doesn't mean that it didn't stir up something inside of me that I don't understand right now. So if you ain't got nothing to do with your other million things you got to do this week, I would really appreciate your prayers. Because I am leading on empty right now. I've never said that publicly. My daddy raised me that you ain't got no punk in you. You just man up and you make things happen. And I've been making things happen and I'm paying the price for it right now. And all you can do is cry because you're so messed up. But here's what I know. I just got one story out of all the stories in here. And some of you are in the same condition that I am, man. Your slap wore out. And you just need to get connected back to the right source. You just need to slow down life a little bit. And it's okay to disappoint people sometimes so that you can be approved by him. Sometimes you have to say no to the wrong things so you can say yes to the right things. You hear what I'm telling you? And that's what this week is all about. I have no desire to go, but I'm going because I would rather work through it. But I feel like the Lord is urging me right now to pray for some people that are on their last leg. And you don't know what you're going to do, and you're discouraged just like Mary was, and you don't understand what God is doing. I'm telling you this morning, you don't have to understand to stay connected. You don't have to understand. So I just want everyone to bow your head this morning. If I had any altar workers, I want my altar workers to come. And I know we're going to run into traffic issues out there, but I'm more concerned about people's hearts getting fixed than I am traffic. Maybe you're even supposed to be on the altar team today and you don't need to pray for somebody. You need somebody to pray for you. And that's okay too. But you're here this morning, man, and you heard everything I preached. You heard everything I said. And you just need God to meet you. I want you to ask the Holy Spirit real quickly before you decide whether you're going to come for prayer or not for prayer. I want you to ask the Holy Spirit, what are you saying to me? What is my takeaway this morning? Did I come here? Did you set me up, God, just so I could leave here with a little bit of encouragement? Did you set me up here today, God, just so I don't give up? Did you put me in this place this morning so I would finish my race? And if you got your answer, I don't want you to raise your hand. I just want you to move. We want to pray with you this morning. Don't wait on anybody else. It's perfectly fine. We pray for people every week. Every week. Yeah, God bless you for coming, man. Don't miss this. Don't miss. This doesn't mean you're not saved. It just means, you need a little help. Let us pray for one another, encourage one another.